Jones Act. On March 2, 1917, President Woodrow Wilson signed the Jones-Shafforth Act. This law gave Puerto Ricans U.S. citizenship. The Jones Act separated the executive, judicial, and legislative branches of Puerto Rican government, provided civil rights to the individual, and created a locally elected bicameral legislature. The two houses were a Senate consisting of 19 members and a 39-member House of Representatives. However, the governor and the president of the United States had the power to veto any law passed by the legislature. Also, the United States Congress had the power to stop any action taken by the legislature in Puerto Rico. The U.S. maintained control over fiscal and economic matters and exercised authority over mail services, immigration, defense, and other basic governmental matters. Jones-Shafforth Act Maritime Law, the Jones Act quote. Two kinds of laws are called civil law, which is the law of the land, and one is maritime admiralty, which is called the law of water. Maritime admiralty is banking law, and the law of the maritime admiralty says that you, because you came out of your mother's water, are a maritime admiralty product. This is why the ship is sitting in its berth and is tied to the dock, and the captain has to give a certificate of manifest to the port authorities. Because money is changing hands, this is why when you were born you have to have a birth certificate. Birth certificate. Notice where the mother signs on the birth certificate where it says parent or other informant. It has to be signed by the doctor, cause that's where the ship is tied to, so the doc signs your birth certificate. Why? Because you came out of your mother's water, you came down her birth canal, you are a maritime admiralty product. Therefore your birth certificate is signed by your mother, and where your mother signed on the birth certificate you will see it does not say parent or mother, it says informant. Your mother was informing the bank that she has just produced another product to be bought and sold. Ship at port. Maritime admiralty says that you, because you came out of your mother's water, are a maritime admiralty product. This is why the ship is sitting in its berth and is tied to the dock, like a umbilical cord. When considering the extent to which our own government aided and abetted Nazi war criminals following World War II, and to the extent our history is tainted with egregious lies and false statements, I am not hesitant to consider the potentiality of the claims made below. If in fact the severity of BS is to the extent which it is, that we are living amidst flagrant denial of our rights, the federal income tax is an extant tax and cannot be levied upon every citizen, and yet totally oblivious to the extent our behavior is reinforced through bias in perception. Perhaps the totality of truth-seeking is affirmation of wish fulfillment, that somehow society is amiss with double standards. England, the British Crown through international banking owns your physical body, and that's the law. The bottom line is that you're a maritime admiralty product, and therefore the banks own your body. On the back of the social security card will be numbers in red, on the front will be blue or black, but on the back they will be in red. The numbers on the back of the SS card in red designate your body, it is the serial number of your stock. This is why if you're wealthy you're preferred stock. If you're poor, you're common stock, but you're a stock on the stock market. Your body is bought and sold through the use of your birth certificate. If you could get your original birth certificate back, you would find that on the back of the birth certificate are all banks around the world. All over the world, banks have used your birth certificate because you are a stock in a maritime admiralty banking scheme where you make money for banks. So consequently the corporation and government and people who want to control you, they create a second you, and that second you that they control, that they created, is all in capital letters. Revenue, check it out. Anytime you get a bill, lawsuit, fine, ticket, utility bill, driving license, social security card, insurance cards, anything period. Anything having to do with business, your name will always be in all capital letters, because only all capital letters can be dealt with by banks and government. Anytime you have a name upper and lower case that applies to you, I have no control over you. You sign a contract in which your name is in all capital letters. Now I can take you to court, now I can take you. As a matter of fact, the judge sits on the bench, he rules from the bench. The word bench in Latin is a bank, look it up in a Latin dictionary. So the judge rules from the bench, right? Because he ruling for the bank, why? Because someone's got to pay. It's just a game here. The Queen of England wants her cut of the American blood, She wants her peace, so someone's got to pay, and the money's going to go where? Into a bank. That's right, the judge rules for the bank. So consequently, if you work in California making money, you're then referred to as a franchisee of a foreign corporation. 1849 Constitution of the State of California says that no Californian citizen will ever pay taxes in California state ever. There will never be a state tax in California ever. That's the Constitution in California. But if you say you're a United States citizen, you're saying you work for a privately owned corporation called the United States, therefore you're a franchisee of a foreign corporation, therefore you must pay the California Franchise Tax Board, not the California State Board. There is no state tax because you're a franchisee of a foreign corporation on the maritime banking international law. You work for the Queen of England. Your butt is owned by the Queen of England in a corporation called the United States, whilst a man called Bush is the president of the British corporation. You want to talk treason? You need to wake up and find out how this stuff really works. Once you understand that you do not need to submit yourself as an American to a British commercial venture called courts, you're an American, you don't need to go to court. You only go to court cause you agree to go to court. When they send you a summons to court, you look at it and say, that's not me, it's in all capital letters, that's a corporation, it's a corpse, it's dead, do I look like I'm dead to you? Grand Lodge, you do not need the British Grand Lodge Masonic system called courts coming out of England manipulating, lying, and exploiting people. Everyone in America thinks they have to go to court. I don't go to anyone's court, I'm an American. I don't need to go to court. That's the difference between being free and being a slave. The system, the federal government acting on behalf of King's Commerce, intended to gradually divest Americans of their natural-born rights and common law through luring them into the fictitious and corrupt world of the federal government and its notion of fair laws, such as the 14th Amendment, state citizen, reliance on state-sponsored social welfare, hidden contracts with compelled performance, and at the end of the day, state-granted privileges in exchange for God-given rights. A few more significant trappings you did not mention: marriage license, Fed Reserve, currency backed by substance-less green ink on white paper, IRS, alphabet soup of security services, FBI/CIA/NSA/FEMA, and the most recent abomination, Homeland Security, IN, 1, Codec, Act 21, Sustainable Development. Many people today have been conditioned to believe that all these trappings are essential necessities of life which they otherwise could not survive without, without ever having tried. So the real danger is, and has been for decades, that the government ultimately has what they want, a populace who has been conditioned to believe that without Uncle Sam to rely on, they will all shrivel up and die. Meanwhile, has anyone ever actually taken a moment to contemplate any of these trappings in the first place? Such as, why does the government need to sanction marriage, and what was forfeited, the fine print, by the wedded when they signed the license? With these kinds of hidden contracts, for which we have our system of lawyers to thank, the very type the original Constitution forbade from holding public office, there are always things given up in exchange for government privilege. It's the way they do business, but one has to first be cognizant enough in the first place to even contemplate these things to see them for what they are. For a lot of people, they have yet to notice, feel, or experience firsthand the force of the heavy hand of our federal government. They are still quite content to go through life comfortably numbed by what the TV and the media tells them to be satisfied with, so it's naturally easier for them to continue living the illusion. But there is an increasing crowd of Americans who've had the unfortunate experience of going into the King's Court of Law, essentially lawless, for various reasons, and those who came out the other side did so confused, wondering what happened to the notion of their constitutional protections. It's hard for people to first realize, but eventually they do acknowledge and admit that somewhere along the line, they unwittingly, tacitly, waived them in exchange for government-sponsored handouts. The silver lining in this dark cloud is that for those people who have experienced the hand of the government, which is happening with far greater frequency these days thanks to modern enhancements such as Patriot Act I and II, for those who survive, it serves as a rude but necessary wake-up call to shake them from their state-sponsored PJ slumbers. Update on Social Security card. On the back of the Social Security card will be numbers in red, on the front will be blue or black, but on the back they will be in red. The numbers on the back of a SS card in red designate your body, it is the serial number of your stock. If you lose your card, however, it's really not yours, but the government's. Check the wording on the back of the card. This card belongs to the Social Security Administration and you must return it if we ask for it. You'll be issued another one to carry and the red number, or blue one in my case, will be different from your previous card. This number is only a certificate accountability number for that particular card. And, having this number allows the paperwork for the card to be sold into the commercial marketplace and generate more fiat money and debt.